Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Very good day to you. Welcome to another edition and finally back with Health Matters in our new brand spanking, not time, but just after a month of Ramadan. So we do feel a little bit refreshed, renewed in every way, heart, body and soul, alhamdulillah. I'm Khawa Solomon and please do stay with us for the next hour or so, inshallah. So you can interact with us, but unfortunately not live at the moment. But please go to ITV's page and any of the shows that you have missed, you can catch on YouTube. So today, inshallah, we're going to try and do justice on how to keep that momentum going after this holy month of Ramadan. We know that so much has happened. Our sleeping patterns, our food intake, of course, and not our family time, you know, the extra spiritual things that we needed to do, that we want to do, that our heart longed for. And also just, I think, you know, our mindset changed somehow. So today we're going to break that and a little bit more down with regards to, inshallah, the intention was there during the holy month of Ramadan. It was sad to see it leave, but now we want to get going on this idea of the intentions that was originally made during this holy month of Ramadan. So please do stay with us. We have psychiatrist and clinical nutritionist in studio with us. Thank you so much, Dr. Leila Paruk. Shukran so much for being here with us. Assalamu alaikum, and I hope we have a good show, inshallah.
Welcome.
And of course, no stranger to ITV viewers, Elenia Kalakotronis. There we go.
Good.
And got it right the first time. Thank you so much to you as well for joining us. And we hope that your expertise will help our viewers get ready for as they build up that whole momentum during the holy month of Ramadan and then get set to keep it going. So let's kick off. Dr. Paruk, psychiatrist, practices at the day clinic in Oxford, Saxony and Johannesburg, and she works at a weekly dual diagnosis clinic at the Chris Hani Baragwanath Academic Hospital and holds a position of associate lecturer at Witwatersrand. So we would like to you, Doc, to kick us off with what we need to know with regards to the change in our lives that happened during this holy month of Ramadan that we just saw. Now, physically, we know there was changes, the diet, the sleep, mentally, and so much more. How does these changes condition our body, our mind, at least, during Ramadan? And so we can understand our mindsets of what we left and hopefully, you know, carry through with that, inshallah.
So I think that the human body and mind is regulated by biorhythms. And the biorhythms start off annually, so which is mediated by the sun, so the four seasons in the year.
Okay.
And then we have lunar rhythms, which are our monthly rhythms, which is what our Islamic calendar is based on. Mm-hmm. And then we have daily rhythms, which is also sunset and sunrise and related to day and night. Mm. And that's mediated by melatonin in our brains and circadian rhythms. Okay. So Islam is much, much more than, you know, a belief system, in that Islam fits in pretty perfectly with all three of those biorhythms, where the entire religion is quite rhythmic. We do certain things once a year. We fast once a year for a month. We do Hajj once a year. And then on a monthly level, there's the lunar calendar that we follow. Mm. And then on the day-to-day rhythm, the fast is quite specific around your circadian rhythm. You start fasting when the sun rises and you stop fasting when the sun sets. Mm. So I think that what fasting does for us is that it helps us reconnect with our natural biorhythms, which the mind likes, because people who are in touch and in tune with their daily, monthly and annual rhythms are the most mentally healthy. Mm. So when we fast, we almost forced to be more mindful and fit into that, and that makes it why we feel so good at the end of it.
So quickly, a lot of us, and a layperson, cannot, at least sometimes even our children, cannot quite understand what mindfulness is about. In simple layman terms, what is that?
So the simplest the definition that I've heard about mindfulness is the ability to observe yourself in a non-judgmental way, and practice that.
Okay, and put it and see that.
So you can give So the observation part is important, and the non-judgmental part is important.
Okay.
And the observation is usually associated with the senses.
Mm-hmm.
So observe how you feel, observe what you can hear, observe what you can see, observe what you can taste, observe what you can touch.
Wow, interesting. Yeah. All the senses.
Yes.
And actually realizing that you can see them when you physically do it and absorb that. Wow. Okay. Brilliant stuff, Elenia. I know you're a spiritual being, so this attracts you tremendously.
It's all true, that's why.
Yes, absolutely. I love it all. So we want to ask you the same question, and what exactly happens to our body during the month of Ramadan. I know that you explained it beautifully just before we had our last show before Ramadan. Just take us to that again.
So I'm a nutritionist, and we look at food as a healer and food to support you. But there's a lot of healing going on when you don't eat. So we spoke about this the last time I was here, that fasting, you know, nowadays everyone's calling it intermittent fasting, but people have been doing that for ages. Lots of traditions and religions do it. And what happens is when the body isn't getting food or nutrition or energy, it can do many things. And one of the most important things that it does is that it starts to clean itself, cleanses itself, pushes out everything that's been stuck there. A lot of detoxification, a lot of cleansing. And what happens is that obviously what the body and the mind do together, if it's good, is good overall. It's a spherical good approach. Mm. So we have to be very clear about what fasting is and what starvation is. And it's not the same. Very often, if I'm meeting with parents who are concerned about the child fasting, I let them know that there is no starvation there.
Okay.
People and children have been doing it for ages. It's such a good way of grounding yourself and being present. And a lot of the time, if you speak to someone, they're not really aware of why they're eating. More often than not, people eat when they're not hungry. And when there's a fast going on, whether it's for religious purposes or to try and just become more aware of what you're doing and what you're eating and why, you find that a mind shift happens, and it's usually more positive than negative. So I love fasting for many reasons. We said this before. And that's one of the many reasons why it's quite necessary, obviously, if the person is physically and mentally fit to do so.
So what you're saying is our body is not, in fact, starving. It's actually using its reserves and detoxing at the time when we're not eating.
Correct.
Okay. So, Dr. Parukh, is there a science behind fasting with regards to conditioning the mind within that 29 or 30 days?
So I tried to do a little bit of background research, and I found that particularly in the last 10 years, there's been a lot of interest into understanding what happens to the mind when calorie levels drop. And quite a few things happen, and it's been really interesting. So what happens is after 24 to 48 hours, you can see that the brain becomes more plastic. There's a term called neuroplasticity. And what neuroplasticity is that it's what the research shows is that when you put the brain under good stress, which is a low calorie diet or a non-calorie diet, the good stress causes something called brain-derived neurotrophic factor to be released. So that BDNF is like a growth hormone for the brain. So it causes the neurons to function more effectively. It causes pruning of the kind of not very healthy neurons to happen. So those are cleaned up and taken away. And overall, it's almost like a spring clean of the brain. So that's neuroplasticity and BDNF. And you see that 48 hours to 5 to 10 days after starting to fast.
Okay.
Intermittent fast, of course, you know, not constantly fasting. So, and then what after that is that the brain starts to release the endogenous endorphins. And that's why people start feeling, in the beginning, you're sluggish and you're detoxing or withdrawing from your various addictions like sugar and caffeine and perhaps nicotine. But after 5 to 10 days, the endogenous opioids and endorphins are what causes the euphoric feeling from fasting.
It's interesting, the intermittent fasting, which we're gonna talk about, and the continuous fasting and mindfulness, they become, now you are more aware of your senses and you know what's going on. So After 10 days,
I think fasting,
what's happening to us?
I think that process continues.
Okay.
But remember, there's the monthly fast that we do that lasts the whole month. It's intermittent fasting because you after 12 or 15 or 20 hours you're eating. So we still call it intermittent fasting.
Yeah.
However, it's intermittent, I guess, progressive or repetitive fasting. But also, you know, it's quite common, and it's recommended in our religion to keep a sunnah fast, which is twice a week.
Yes.
And that's almost exactly what the nutritionists and dietitians are recommending
From a health perspective.
Absolutely. So definitely going to be digging into more of that a little bit later on. But to you, Elena, we've got 2 minutes before we take a break, and I want to quickly push this in because there's been lots of questions of people around the world that are fasting more than the 16 hours that, you know, usually is recommended. So they're doing like 18 to 20 hours. And to others, possibly that is not medically correct. There isn't even possibly, you know, the starvation point. So just explain to us what this is doing to one's body, because people that doesn't really understand Islam are saying, you know, negative things. But when I speak to relatives and friends that are actually doing this in the UK, they feel so good because of whatever the mind is doing, whatever's happening. What are your comments to this?
I think that if it's being done correctly, in other words, the person is of the correct age, has not got a major illness, a mental or physical illness or a disability or whatever it is, I think that it can stand them in good stead depending on the factors that go with that fast. Yeah. If they're doing high stress jobs or they're under major strain, mental or physical, it could have side effects. However, I do know of a close personal family friend, she and her entire family, they're all adults. The youngest is 19. Mm. They've done that before, and the only thing they ever say is that they feel mentally enlightened all the time, and that eventually they say that it's quite stressful the first few days, but after that they say that they become, the words were, we're on another level. And I understood that. I must be, I've never done an 18-hour fast.
I know.
My most was 16, and I was okay. But I haven't explored that.
2 hours just to push it,
I should try it. Then I'll be able to speak from experience, let you know how I feel.
Well, often those people try and come, if they have family this side of the world, they try and come here, whoever's having winter. But you know what? At the end of the day, they're able to do it. They're challenging.
They are
and
able.
As you say, mentally uplifted. If only we pray that we actually reach that level.
And also just to add that afterwards, there is no side effect. They haven't become ill afterwards. They haven't had any major muscle loss afterwards. Okay. There's just weight. There's nothing major that's happened to them afterwards, so it can't be that bad.
No, we actually need to get to that level. Thanks so much to our panel as we continue our discussion on how to keep that momentum going, that mind, body and soul, and more the food as well. During the holy month of Ramadan, now we see a bit of a downfall. We go back to our old ways, but they're here to help us get through getting that momentum. Keep going. Not back in a moment. Stay with us. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back. A very good day to you. This is Health Matters as we tackle on how to keep that momentum going after the holy month of Ramadan, and we pray. And I think ultimately it's just to speak to our Maker, to like, how do you want me to worship you? How do you want me to be with you? And how do you want me to love you? And often after Ramadan, we feel a bit lost because this beautiful month has just left us and we wish it could stay. But it's there for a month for a reason, as Dr. Baruch has taken us through, psychiatrist as well as clinical nutrition. Elena in studio with us, guiding us and helping us mind, body and soul prepare for that, keeping that going, that momentum going after this beautiful month of Ramadan. And know that fasting is always there for us to do, which we'll also talk about a little bit later on through Sunnah fasting. So quickly, Dr. Baruch, we spoke about children, we spoke about the mindset, we spoke about, mindfulness, because that often it's a very common word being used now by therapists and not all of us understand it. So shukran for breaking it down a little bit early on. But what exactly is happening to our children through this conditioning of minds?
Full minds, because it is about thinking about being mindful in complete opposition to having full minds, because we all have full minds, particularly our children sometimes, you know, because they're so busy with so many things. And so the thing about children and fasting, I think it's a whole topic on itself, but from a mental perspective, once kind of you make sure that everything is appropriate in terms of their health, their eating, remember children have a smaller a larger surface area compared to their body volume and weight. So, you know, you have to be very certain that their morning meal and their evening meal is well taken care of. And once all of that is sorted out, I think, like with adults, because we all need it, what fasting does is that it establishes in that structure and routine and that rhythmic action of the fast, it establishes a discipline. And that discipline is one that causes children to become more aware, and adults, of themselves in the context of what they're eating, what they're putting into their bodies. And children are often not aware about hunger, for example. So, you know, they play through two breaks at school, and then their mom fetches them in the car, and then they melt down because they haven't eaten anything all day. So I think what fasting does for children is it teaches them a discipline, and it teaches them a form of mindfulness in terms of an awareness of what they're putting into their bodies, what hunger means, what thirst means, and how that can impact on their mental state.
And they can cope. I mean, I've just had my three little ones at a new school and a new environment with literally them being the only Muslims at the school and teaching others about fasting.
I think children are the most adaptable, and they're also on some level the most mindful. So we can learn a lot from children on a mindful level from them being in the moment. And being aware of that moment rather than worrying about the shopping list and what happened yesterday. And
they do come home with stories, though. And then you have to nudge them, oh, just another 2 hours, another 3 hours.
Yes.
And it's amazing that when they do that play and they keep their minds busy, they forget about that they needed to eat anyways. Can I say, but you forgot
they're
about it.
They're a lot hardier than what we think they are.
Yeah. They
can handle a lot more.
And like Dr. Parag said, we can actually learn from them.
Correct.
Yeah. So, Elenia, now after the fact, and I know you said earlier on fasting after, 20 hours, sometimes you don't have to recoup. But, you know, people are still asking this. Presently, our bodies are feeling very different now.
They would.
And it's sad as well. I mean, our bodies are feeling different, but yet our mind is also being a bit sad, you know, not going back to that sort of daily routine of Ramadan, because it does also allow you to put yourself in a schedule. Is it necessary for your body to recoup after this month?
I think everything has to recoup because it's such a huge change. And there is a change. I mean, I know a lot of people think to themselves, well, you were doing fasting and now you're not, just watch what you eat. But the truth is, and I mentioned this the last time we were together, I worked with a lovely lady who was nervous about what she was going to do after the fast because she was on antidepressants and she found that a couple of weeks into it, she didn't need it anymore and she was scared. So it's a lot of things. It's not just what you're putting in your mouth.
Yeah.
There's a lot to go with it. And there's a huge shift as well. You have to be very, very mindful, the word mindful, of what you're going to do afterwards. Anyone who goes on a binge, high sugar, high fat, eating incessantly, you see all kinds of, you see blood infections, you see incessant bloat, you see weight gain overnight, you see mentally also there's a lot that is not good.
Okay.
You have to ensure that when you stop a fast, you go, you make that transition as smoothly and as correct as possible.
So what is that, what must that transition look like when we are at our
It needs to be a balanced variety of all food groups in its most natural form. In other words, the right carbohydrates. Everyone's like, oh, carbohydrate, no. But you do need it. If you're an active physical being, you need these foods. The right amount of proteins. What kind of proteins? You need the right amount of, obviously, waters. A lot of people don't realize how much water they actually need. Just balanced eating, and it cannot be, this is what I advocate, it cannot be one or two meals a day. It needs to be every 4 to 4.5, and depending on the person again, how often. It needs to be an incessant, not incessant, sorry, that's the wrong word. You have to keep your digestive system ongoing.
Okay. So during Ramadan, we're doing, you know, two big meals sometimes. Some people are not even doing breakfast sometimes because they can't, you know, eat that early. They're doing this
huge meals
at the evening and some fatty, some crazy stuff. And also, you know, some people are saying, listen, I'm going to take this time to eat properly. So now we're going from one and a half meal to like saying, okay, 4 meals. What is within those 4 meals? Because that sounds so much.
It sounds like a lot. But the thing is, it's not heaped plates of food.
Okay.
And your smallest meal should preferably be in the evening. So we're swapping it around only because you're eating incessantly now, whereas before you were having these huge gaps, this huge gap, rather to say. And so just for the first couple of days or weeks going into that transition, you have to introduce things to your body slowly. Mm-hmm. So when we're saying you need smaller meals throughout the day, that's what we mean. We mean smaller meals, okay. Even snacking, handful of almonds, a fruit, children, a sandwich, mm-hmm. whatever it is. It needs to just be balanced, and it cannot be 1, 2, 3 huge heap plates of food in the day. It's not going to stand your body in good stead.
So we're always advocating that water, water, water. And this is one thing that we didn't have throughout the day of fast. So, they could argue, but listen, I stayed without water for so long. It's okay if I don't do it, afterwards again, because they never liked water anyways. Because that's one of the arguments of someone I know.
But you weren't eating. Yeah. When you do eat, however, to aid digestion and to add peristalsis of the food in your digestive system and elimination, or you need lubrication, you need hydration, and you need to get that from water.
Okay, so either start fasting again and then you can stay away from water. Okay, Dr. Baruch, many of us feel a bit sleep deprived after this month of Ramadan, and yet they according to our usual sleeping patterns, and then yet there are some that are feeling a bit sluggish because of this, up and down, whatever happened, the pattern during Ramadan. And then there are so many of us that are feeling different but invigorated as well. Just explain this thinking of what's happening.
I think sleep is a science, a whole study in itself. Mm. And it comes back to my original point of in Ramadan, there usually, and there should be, an awareness, and you're just much more aware of your physical self in that month, because you're aware of what's going into it, you're aware of needing to keep to quite a structured routine in your day, and you're almost kind of ruled by the clock. Okay. And so from what we know from mental health kind of research, more and more circadian rhythms have become very, very important in treating all sorts of mental health disorders. And the reason is because melatonin, which is the hormone that regulates sleep, works almost like a seesaw with cortisol, which is your stress hormone.
Okay.
So your body releases melatonin at 6 p.m., naturally when the sun is setting. And your body releases cortisol at 6 a.m. to help you get up, get out of your cave, hunt and gather.
Okay.
And so if your melatonin level drops because you're not sleeping appropriately, or there's too much of light, or you jet lagged, or you work shifts, or for whatever reason, then your cortisol level goes up.
Okay.
So once again, it comes to the importance of going to bed when the sun sets and waking up when the sun rises, which is what Ramadan is about. Once again,
it's interesting that we keep to such a beautiful schedule during this month of Ramadan,
which is what our bodies want us to do, which is what our minds want us to do. So and now science is seeing that over and over again. Mm. We just see it. We see. Islam replicated in science 1500 years later over and over again.
Yeah. So I know this was a question that I wanted to leave a little bit later on, but what is it? Why is it so hard for us to make these choices that Ramadan forces us to make for the rest of the year?
That's an interesting question.
I just think that when you are doing something along with a community, I think that if you're doing something that everyone around you in your environment that you are familiar with is doing, it automatically becomes okay.
Yeah,
it's fine. The minute you don't need to do it, whether you're in the community or not, then it's also okay.
Yeah.
I think that's...
No, that's very true. When you're doing it together, that's what I always say. When you do a diet, find a friend. If you're going to go exercise, find a friend.
That's why if someone is doing a meal plan for their child, the entire family, our advocate needs to adopt it.
Yeah.
And that's why it needs to be realistic. Because if everyone's doing it, the child, depending on the age, doesn't really know what's going on. But it's the most amazing thing when everyone else is doing something, how easy it becomes. Okay. It's if you're singular, if you're alone doing it, it's very hard.
So if you're going to be doing a diet and you're doing little small meals for yourself, have everybody else do
it.
On
board.
It, because they're all going to benefit from it. But not just to lose weight, but to just be healthy.
It's the I always tell people that skinny is not healthy. Yeah. Skinny is not healthy.
Okay.
It might look better for some people, but it's health that matters. It really is. It really, really is health that matters. I see it all the time.
Because you hear that. I don't know, in your family, in your friend circle, Dr. Parut, they're saying, we fasted, but I didn't lose a single kilo.
That's not how it works at all. That's not at all how
it works. Why didn't I lose a kilo?
No. doesn't work like that.
Yeah. And it's not about that. Yes. It's about the health of your cells. It's about the health of the molecules. It's about the health of the neurons.
And also just following such a beautiful ancient practice. It's so beautiful. Mm. Everyone's always looking at the physicality of something, yes. how it looks yes. outside. But internally, that's what matters.
Okay, so we built a foundation on how to keep this you know, momentum going. In the first week, many of us have started to feel, you know, weak, as Dr. Baruch said, a bit sluggish and slowly recovering, you know, after the whole 10-day, 15-day, just to keep it going. And you feel a little bit better later on until you reach the end and you feel so great and you want to continue this, and then Eid hits you. which you must eat, and then you go all out. You go with a whole bang lot, a whole festivities of meals, from seafood to meat to chicken to savories to sweets, and you can't eat all of that. And then you get to the next day where you have leftovers, which is brilliant for the next week. But then you still remember, listen, Ramadan was just here. I still want to go back there. I still want to do what I used to do. I still want to finish those leftovers, but I missed Ramadan so much. The sort of environment, the holistic approach to it. My kids were calmer. We are calmer during this month of Ramadan. So take us through, I think, you know, the hearty meals, the beautiful dishes that we had, because when we fast, we want to eat things that are going to stick in our stomach. So, you know, everybody, your mom and dads are nutritionists at that moment during the month of Ramadan. They're telling, you know, all the grannies and aunts and uncles are experts, you know, have that date, have that, because such beautiful things that you're eating during Ramadan.
Good.
And now you forget about all of that until you see Ramadan again next year, which hopefully we will be at. But we want to, you know, bring back still the soups and the halim and that date that we only see festively eating during this month. How can we still implement all of that during, you know, or after, you know, Ramadan and
it's
stuff?
It's not, and I do this often, especially after, it's not a big deal.
Mm.
It really is not a big deal. You can still, if you want to fast.
Okay.
If you want to eat less.
Mm.
Do what works for you. What happens is we're given free rein after that.
Yeah.
And it's just, I mean, Greek Orthodox people fast too often. Mm. And so, you know, they feel so good and everything's great. And then afterwards they just go completely wild. It's a savage affair. And then they feel sick. But the truth is that they feel sick because they've done it so wrong.
Mm.
The food's there. It's going to be there whether you eat it in excess or not.
Okay.
If you felt better eating less or not eating at all during those times, and continue doing that mentally. I find that a lot of the people I work with, it's not so much weight or energy. It's how they feel mentally,
okay.
and how they feel they can function, and how their body moves better, and how their digestive system works with less food. And I try and explain to them that it's not so much about eating less or eating more. It's about where they're at mentally and physically,
okay.
because, and I said this to the doctor, the two go hand in hand. And I know it's such a silly thing to say, because people say it all the time, you are what you eat, or your mind and body have to work together in conjunction to get, but that's the truth.
Are we going to expound on that? And that's why I love this duo of guests that I have with me today, of how we need to keep that momentum going after the holy month of Ramadan, mind, body and soul, as well as the food, still eating less, I hope. And Dr. Baruch is going to expound a bit on what Elena just left us now with. Back in a moment. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. This is Health Matters every Tuesday. And remember, you can catch any of the shows that you have missed on the YouTube channel itvnetworks.tv, streaming live wherever you are in the world as well. So, Elenia and Dr. Baruch, we have, like I said, a dynamic duo to deal with this topic and getting and keep going after Ramadan with the beautiful practices. I want Dr. Baruch, please, now, if you could expand on what Elenia said on how to keep that momentum, that mindset. And she has mentioned something important, you know, if everybody's doing it, it's a community, it's sort of a, you know, I also want to get into that mode. But after New Year, and I don't know how common it is here in Johannesburg, but in Cape Town, they will say, and if you meet with the non-Muslims, they're also fasting with us.
Correct.
So beautiful, like the community, the friends would do it. And they will say, gosh, you know, you guys are very different Ramadan, like, you know, because they're not smoking, they're not as aggressive, they're not, you know, they're just more calmer. Not to say that they're generally like that, but just they're different. And one person commented and they said, you know, I wish you guys could always be like this during Ramadan. And I wish we could, in fact.
I think we underestimate the brain's power of habit.
Hmm.
So anything, if done repetitively enough, becomes almost second nature and habitual.
Mm.
So it's not impossible to incorporate the mindful eating, the awareness, the routine, the rhythm, the structure that Ramadan brings into our daily life, whether we're fasting or not.
Mm.
And then over and above that, it's very easy to incorporate a once a week or twice a week fast as well into your...
And Elena mentioned, you know, the science of fasting and what it does to the brain. So from your side, what is it actually doing to the brain when you're eating the right things?
So, you know, when I was invited to talk, I wondered how I could add value to this talk. But I do feel quite strongly about people needing to understand the relationship between the gut and the mind.
Correct.
And that we have, so serotonin is a neurotransmitter. It's a hormone that you get in your brain, and it's the one that mediates the circuits of joy, of happiness, also the anxiety circuits, also the obsessive circuits.
Mm.
We have more serotonin receptors in the lining of our gut than we do in our brain.
Good.
So when people say that you can feel in your stomach, you feel emotions in your stomach, it's absolutely true. You literally are feeling it. So that when you're feeling anxious, when you're having a panic attack and you feel that pain in your stomach, or you feel a cramp, that's your serotonin talking.
Good. And it's all happening in your stomach.
So the relationship between the mind and the gut is strongly related to serotonin. But there's also, I think we need to talk about what we call the biome, which is that our gut is, our bodies are full of bacteria. And there's a lot now in the literature about how that bacteria, which some of it we're born with, some of it we get from our mother while we're being born, and some of it we colonize in the first few years of our life, those bacteria are essential in the functioning of our body, the functioning of our brains, and in the disease process. When this biome is disrupted.
Okay.
And what I think fasting might be doing is allowing the biome to regenerate when it's not having to be busy digesting all the time.
So she's also mentioned the fact that when we are eating certain things, it does something to our brain. A cup of tea, you know, often people say, oh, let's have a cup of tea. And it just relaxes you. I was just watching something, and this American who studied in English doesn't need, you know, a headache tablet, or, you know, when she's stressed, she's like, oh, I need to make my cup of tea. You know, so her friends, other American friends, were making fun of her. She said, "Ah, oh, you can see you from, you know, you were spend some time in the UK, or whatever." But it's true. Drinking that cup of tea, whether it's Ceylon or rooibos or, you know, just a chamomile, it does do something to you. So tell us about that connection of the brain.
Well, it comes back to that serotonin receptors in the gut, and those serotonin receptors need to be occupied.
Okay.
Yeah.
And they're being busied with that lovely cup of tea. And also, you know, coffee is a stimulant. Some of the teas also have some caffeine, and a lot of people are going in for green tea. Talk to us about that and how healthy it is are doing that.
I just sent an article off about how people have the misconception of certain foods. So one of them was honey, one of them was dark chocolate, and one was coffee. And how the benefits of these three foods are actually much better than what people think.
Okay.
So I think that we have to first of all become clear about what it is that makes us unhealthy.
Because there was this joke going around just after Ramadan, because everybody could now get to the cup of coffee when they usually do. Yeah.
I think you know, whoever's worked with me, and when I speak or every time I advocate something, it needs to be realistic. And the truth is that the block of dark chocolate or the cup of coffee or the cup of tea, that's not what's going to make you sick. And it's not what's going to make you infertile or aid infertility. Those are not the things that do the damage. So I think that the minute the human being accepts that as long as they're feeding their body enough nourishment, and when I say nourishment, I mean food in its most natural form, raw preferably.
Okay.
a bit of the cooked food, the occasional slice of pizza, the occasional coffee, that's not what's going to damage you.
Like the samosas.
Or the samosas.
So tell us about, I'm not keen to just find out your approach to your clients. When you sort of set up a diet, you talk about wholesome food, you talk about, you know, raw and everything from the goodness of the earth. Is there any mindset that you have to put them in when you do, you know, encourage this diet?
A lot of the times, if we're speaking about what I specialize in, and that's female fertility, male fertility too, but female fertility is the main focus.
Okay.
You're sitting with a phenomenal woman who's been told that she can't do something that she desperately wants. And the number one mistake that anyone on this earth, I don't care if you're a professor or a doctor or someone in the street, you cannot tell one person what their body cannot do. Mm. Only because the body has proven many people wrong all the time.
Yeah.
So we sit down and we discuss, unless, and I'm very honest, unless there really is a trauma, an abuse or major damage, or then we look at another way forward. Mm. But the number one thing is to ease them and tell them that no one can put a limit on what their body can do, because no one can.
Mm.
No one can. Secondly, the meal plan for them is a meal plan, not a diet, only because how I eat won't serve this person and their family in good stead. Mm-hmm. So we speak a lot, what they do, the times they eat, what they eat and don't for either religious purposes or for personal preferences. If they have children, what their lifestyles are like, are they active, do they travel a lot, that matters. Are they very stressful? Stress, guys. Stress is on another level. We've discussed this. We'll discuss it another day. And so the meal plans are very realistic for them, for their life.
Yeah.
And more often than not, they are beautiful results. Beautiful results. Yeah. Only because their bodies don't need a lot. A lot of the times, the body just wants to either be left alone or nourished and supported, mentally and physically.
Yeah. I love how you know, sort of specialize in something that you relate to, so it's your passion.
I love
and
it.
And on it
I
goes.
Love it. Thank you.
So that connection between the mind and putting your mind to doing something that you need to do, how different is it when the community is doing it, or if your loved ones are doing it, your family is doing it, and, you know, you go with the flow, and now you're deciding that, listen, I still want to keep doing it. I want to do what I did in Ramadan. I want to get back to that spirit, that holistic approach to my, you know, eating, to walking out by the door, sitting on my prayer mats. How do you keep that going, Dr.
Well, Patrick? It's obviously easier, as Alenia says, when you're doing it in a community or in a group of people. But I think as humans, we also very good at providing or putting obstacles in our path.
Okay.
You know, I can't do this because, I can't go to gym because. And so I think it's about keeping it as simple as possible and as matter of fact as possible.
Mm.
And stacking the odds in your favor.
Mm.
So it's going to be more difficult if you isolate yourself, or if you make it hard for yourself. Okay. So don't.
So should you find a partner, a cousin, a friend?
Of course. Oh, yeah, for sure.
That's what's so wonderful. Women are, and men are amazing too, but women are a lot more proactive in that.
Yeah.
I need to go to gym. I cannot do it alone. I need you. Drag your friend or your sister or your cousin out of
bed. We're so good at doing that.
We're so
good.
I love that about women.
Mm.
We always, you know, trying to help each other out, and that's such a wonderful thing. It is always easier.
Yeah.
It's always easier if you have someone with you.
Absolutely. Find a friend. Call a friend.
Find a friend.
Okay, so I want to quickly get into our immune system.
Yes.
We know at the beginning of Ramadan, it was feeling sluggish, and it's amazing how we pick up after that and then absolutely phenomenal at the end. But now, this beautiful, I love winter, so that's why I say beautiful weather hit us, but Joburg's pretty different, and of course the other provinces as well. How do we keep up with the change of weather, the change of climate, traveling, building our immune system? Because now, yes, Ramadan has left us, so that we're kind of going back to normal with our traveling, our lifestyle, you know, what we normally do. And I know vitamin C plays a big role. The fresher, the better, I'm sure. But let's sort of expound on our immune system, boosting our immune system through diet. Do we need vitamin supplements? Do we need that flu vaccine? Take us through that, because people are rushing for all these.
I'm going to probably be shot in the parking lot, but I don't think that you need flu vaccines, because so many people have them and still get sick.
Mm.
So we also need to know that the cold air does not make us ill. That's not what's giving us the flu.
Yeah.
As far as I, you know, I advocate that most of your immune boosting aid has to come from food.
Mm.
So if you're nourishing your body correctly, And please, I mean, I'm not saying that you need to eat spinach all day, every day. Not at all. I'm just saying that if you give your body enough, it won't need
that
aid.
Yeah,
you know, if you go and you sit in the sun for 15 minutes with your face in the shade, you're doing good. If you're eating enough fruit and vegetables and legumes and, you know, food in a natural form as far as possible, you're doing good. Mm-hmm. You will still, there is still a chance that you will get flu, but that's okay. It's not going to do anything wrong to you. I think people are very misguided. They think that it's winter and they may not get a runny nose or they may not have a cough. That's not how it works, unfortunately. So as long as you're just fortifying your body with good food and enough hydration and enough sleep and enough activity, you'll be fine.
Okay, so there's some bad habits that people have stopped successfully during Ramadan. It's like, okay, Ramadan, I'm going to stop smoking. I'm going to stop drinking, you know, that very sugary cool drinks. And now Ramadan has stopped and they're going back the minute they're going back to that cigarette. They're going back to, you know, some of the bad habits that they really wanted to stop during, you know, Ramadan, and now it's, you know, back to normal. How can they be helped, you know, with their mindset, and they were able to do it with fasting. So now you can really quit this after, not just because it's Ramadan.
I think once again it goes back to that obstacle theory of, if you make things as simple and as easy for yourself, and it comes back to being mindful. So remember, mindfulness is being non-judgmentally observant. And so when you start judging yourself, and human beings are great primarily at being harsh on themselves and then onto the people around them. So when you're able to observe yourself in a non-judgmental way, so for example, if you want to stop eating as much sugar as you do, as much refined sugar, then observe yourself in a day and see, okay, so I had a biscuit for breakfast and I had a Kit Kat at my morning tea, and then at the end of the day you can kind of count up all your sugar. And so what most people do is they think, I had a Kit Kat for tea, so I may as well have a milkshake for lunch.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's that slippery slope theory of, you know, I'm already bad, so I may as well
just
be badder.
Do it properly.
Yeah. And so that's a judgment. Yeah. That's putting a judgment on yourself. So if you, for example, say, I had that Kit Kat for tea, it hit the spot, and so for lunch I'll choose a salad. So that's you not being judgmental on yourself. Because the minute you start judging yourself, that's when you start becoming self-destructive.
It's almost, it reminds me of that excuse. I was listening to Noman Ali Khan, and he was saying that, oh, you'll go to the restaurant and you'll spend all this money, you won't think about adding extra fries or, you know, extra sauce or whatever, which costs a 10 rand and 20 rand and extra. But all of a sudden somebody knocks on the door and they say, oh, you know, we needed some sadaqah, some donation for a mosque, or
correct,
and then you become the best accountant you've ever were.
I love
and you
that.
Work out you know, like, all of a sudden you know, I didn't have that 10 rand. I don't have that 10 rand. I can't do that 20 bucks or that
correct.
5 rand.
So it is about, so, it's about seeing things in a relative sense and seeing things in the bigger picture, that this is something I want to do for myself because it will make my life better in such and such way.
Okay.
Not this is something I want to do because I'm a terrible person and I'm a bad person and I'm useless and I'm, you know, not good enough.
Okay, I want to get back to planning and sort of scheduling, because like I said earlier, Ramadan sort of forces us to do that. So what can we do differently? Because now it's our start. We need to start making changes, and not because, you know, our creator said, listen, you have to do this and you have to do it. Okay, so we'll get back to that and also talk about some wholesome foods, how we can get it on our budgets. We were able to jam pack our freezers with all the crazy eat that we wanted for Ramadan. Let's see how we could do that for the rest of the upcoming months, the wholesome foods that put back in a moment. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back. We're in our last few minutes of how to understand that we need to keep that momentum going during this holy month of Ramadan that has just passed, that has left our doors. And we pray that the Almighty will bless us again when it next arrives. But we have a specialist in studio, Dr. Paruk, our psychiatrist, as well as Elenia Colocotronics. Colocotronics. Oh, well, there we go. Okay. Well, I got it right the first time. Who is specializing in natural female fertility. And I love that, natural. And then she's also working on a doctorate towards clinical nutrition as well. So keep going.
Thank you.
Elenia, we appreciate your advice and enhancing us as a community in that way through your hard work, as well as Dr. Baruch advising us mentally how we can keep this going. So I just want to quickly get back to people making excuses. No, I cannot afford healthy food. Organic stuff is so expensive. The raw stuff is just out of my budget. So again, the mindset and how we can actually, you know, put our minds to budget for that healthy foods, because we could make time and money to fill our freezers with all those beautiful delicacies and fries and stuff. So why not do it for our wholesome foods?
I think that our preferences have changed how we think. I know everyone thinks it's the other way around, but I disagree with that. Our preferences have changed the way we think, and it's made it easy. So the stuff that's not so good for you is always cheaper. But I always tell someone, you don't need to be eating raw foods all day, every day. You know, if you're having some salad and you're having some apples or a carrot or whatever it is, that's not going to break your bank. So instead of buying frozen lasagna, I'm sure you can buy some apples and maybe some carrots or some cucumbers to snack on. It's not hard. We've made it hard for ourselves on purpose because we don't really want to. I'll see time and again if someone is someone who really wants to change for their family or for themselves or for their health or whatever it is, they find a way to do it, and they always come back and say, it's not at all what I thought. It costs the same. Now, the whole story of something organic being more expensive, if you walk into a Woolworths or you walk into, you know, you go to a market, it's always only about R3 or R4 more. Unless you're looking at eggs. I mean, eggs is a story on its own, but it doesn't need to be eggs. If you're just looking specifically at fruit and vegetables, it's never breaking the bank. That's not true, because I checked that out. I researched myself. So it's never as crazy as what people make it out to be. Yeah. People prefer it to be difficult when it's not. It's as simple as that,
absolutely,
really.
Absolutely, I agree.
And grow your own.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we underrate that. From a cost perspective, from a health perspective, there's nothing healthier than something that's grown close to you, with no kind of mass farming
poor
practices. And, you know, yesterday I had a patient who made my day. She's a schizophrenic, and she told me about all the things that she grows in her back garden. And it's also an excellent mindfulness practice. So
I was just going to say that appreciation and that feeling that you get from yourself, you know, that you've done this through the work of the Almighty.
Everything's just become mass-produced, mass-packaged, mass-grown. Grow your own.
We did our herbs. We've got carrots and peas, but they didn't stand a chance once they grew. My sons were in there. But it is. She's right. It's not hard. Correct. It's not hard at all.
And then you share with your neighbors, and then you get to know your neighbors, and then you're less socially isolated.
Positive knock-on
effect. And less depressed, yes.
So it doesn't even sometimes need that medicine, you know. It's just what the earth has already given us. And I know my granny used to tell me about stories. I used to sit and look at this plant and talk to it. And I saw my mother doing the same.
It's a mindfulness practice.
What craziness is this?
But
it was beautiful.
They found a certain tone to a flower or a plant helps it grow, helps the roots become thicker and spread quicker. It's the truth.
So talk to your plants and to your veggies while they're growing.
It's
and say,
a living
listen,
thing, why not?
I want you to grow big and strong for my family.
And it helps with a sense of a mastery and fulfillment and purpose, which I see a lot that people are losing. So being able to create something out of the ground is hugely rewarding.
No one knows that, but my house is full of glass jars with olive pips growing and seeds growing. It's a big thing for me. I love it.
How can you keep that? How can you keep, you know, implement? Because my daughter's also going through this whole, you know, not wasting and water pollution and, you know, highlighting of recycling. And I said to her, my girl, I've been doing it for years. And now they've seen some YouTube videos, which is great, in fact.
Why not?
So, you know, if the outside world is going to influence you, if there's a video, a book that your child's going to be attracted to, how do we keep our children and our family, you know, going in that momentum of, you know, healthy looking and the onset of understanding that, listen, and I know it comes back to your mind and maybe I should be directing it to you, but both of you are so brilliant at answering these questions. And the idea of the mind overpowering that headache that you might have, or, you know, that foot that's paining, and you just, you know, got to speak to your body. Is that really, because some people are believing that it's, you know, it's just a lot of mumbo jumbo. And I for one can say that it has worked.
I think that it's the person that thinks it depends on the person's character and who the person is, if they think it's nonsense or not.
Yeah.
A lot of the times, and the doctor will know, the placebo effect research that they did where someone was in constant pain and the doctor gave them a pill for it and said, yes, it'll make you feel better. Mm-hmm. But the pill was nothing more than a buffered vitamin C. What was it? I don't even remember. And the person was 100% perfect afterwards. Yeah. But then they tried it. Sorry, doctor. Mm-hmm. Then they tried it on a different kind of a person, someone that was very different to the first subject. Okay. And it had no effect on them whatsoever. Mm-hmm. So I think it depends on the person.
So can you reject something that is meant to make you feel better or do something to your body because of your mind?
It's so interesting how this conversation has meandered, but it's great. So I think it comes back to that immunity and immunology conversation we were having earlier. So there's a very interesting field of psychiatry called psychoneuroimmunology. Mm-hmm. And it's pretty much the relationship between the brain and the mind and our immune system. And how the three obviously closely interact, and how the quality of your brain or the health of your brain and the state of your mind has a very direct impact on your hypothalamic pituitary axis, which is where your stress is mediated, and how that in turn kind of helps or mediates your all the cells in your body that fight infection and inflammation. So yes, a healthy body is in a healthy mind.
So that for me ultimately is what we needed to get to for this show, because Ramadan again puts us in a schedule, and I wanted to talk about this, how we can sort of implement certain things and actually with our willpower through our mind take that pen and paper, put up that whiteboard or whatever it is that we need to see to be able to do, to actually keep going, to, you know, decide that I'm going to do the healthier choice. I'm going to, you know, not buy the dishwashing liquid that they say, that I'm going to make my own dishwashing liquid, and I'm going to save a little bit there to buy the wholesome food if it's that extra 4 or 5 rand, and to make that conscious decision on the changes in your life that you have to make to be able to move forward, you know, healthily.
I think also, and you can correct me if I'm incorrect, but research has shown that as a race, humans, over the last 100 years, we just eating more calories. And so we eat too many calories. And most of those calories come from calorie-dense, nutrition-poor food. And the solution is also, just to sum it up from my perspective, is to eat little, often, mostly vegetables.
I like that. You know, there's a huge, if you go to the conferences and all the nutrition conferences and world health conferences, everyone's looking at this, you know, just to hurry it up. Basically, they're saying to eat meat is depleting the world. The world cannot sustain.
It's just eating too much.
Yeah.
And so everyone had this focus on meat, on meat, on meat. But the truth is that people, I believe, for me, are not educated. People don't know. More often than not, I sit with a couple or I sit with a family with their child who's ill. And if you ask them what the child eats, the child only lives on white bread and Coca-Cola and sweets. Oh. It's not because the families are bad. They just don't know, because that's how they grew up.
Yeah.
And then they'll say, oh, well, diabetes is a genetic predisposition. I say to them, maybe, but that's not why the whole family is diabetic, for example. So I think that a lot of education needs to take place, and a lot of people need to understand what food actually does for them. Because what it does, what a potato does for you, it does not do for me.
Yeah.
And so on it goes. And so that's why people said to me, Alanya, how long is a consultation with you? And I said to them, well, I don't know. A consultation with me can be the longest consultation I had was just over 4 hours.
Sure.
And so
that just shows that you put everything into it.
You have to, because I'm not there to put a Band-Aid on.
Yeah.
I'm there to heal.
Yeah.
It has to
from
be
inside.
From inside. And
healing
mentally
inside.
Too.
Yeah.
People need to know what's
healing
going
inside.
On.
So the connection again to the food that is actually the mind healer.
Understanding what they're eating and why and what it's doing.
Okay, so ladies, we have to wrap up. I want to talk about the intermittent fasting and sort of how important is, as we say, the sunnah fasting is, you know, Monday and Thursday, and even every other day, you know, just to take that break. Anything that you, I must say that even if you're going through something mentally or in your house, and after our Almighty will guide us, you know, if you can't get this right, if you can't get this way and things are not going for you, he says fast, you know, fast, because it puts you in a mindfulness.
I agree completely.
To understand what is actually happening and the acceptance. So let's talk about that, Dr. Farooq, intermittent fasting.
So as you know, there's a lot in the literature and in the media and in the zeitgeist about intermittent fasting at the moment. And once again, we've been doing it. And it's really got benefits on various levels. So on your gut and on your cholesterol. And what happens when you fast is your body becomes ketotic. Mm-hmm. And in that ketotic state, there's an anti-inflammatory effect.
Okay.
And so there's a lot, and I'm sorry we didn't have time to get into it, but there's a lot about pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory states.
Okay.
And that pro-inflammatory, anti-inflammatory argument can be applied to every single organ in the body.
Mm.
And there's food that's pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory. Okay. And the two most anti-inflammatory things you can do for every single organ in your body is to exercise and to fast.
Okay. Correct. Exercise and fasten, and I hope we're able to leave the listeners with, you know, those impactful words and also understanding that it does also cleanse the soul.
I agree with that, and I also think that if someone is looking at eating a lot more raw food, mm-hmm. I'm not saying eat like a bunny, I'm just saying up your raw food, you find your thinking patterns and the way your logic and the structure to how you tackle a problem or an issue in your life changes drastically.
Absolutely. So quickly, as a wrap-up, Dr. Farooq, your last words as well as you, Elenia.
I think it's about, I'm here for the mind and she's here for the body.
I just think be kinder. For me, just to be kinder to yourself.
Yeah.
The minute you make one change, everything else changes. And I think the minute I see it, the minute someone is kinder to themselves and they allow themselves to just be flaws and all, there's such a positive knock-on effect.
Absolutely.
So that's it from me.
Thank you so much. And not just completely, but we will be seeing Elena and her expertise as well as Dr. Farooq. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.
A psychiatrist and a clinical nutritionist.
Thank you.
Having us chat about, we definitely now going to keep that momentum going.
You lovely.
After this beautiful month of Ramadan. Thank you so much. And as Elena said, plant that seed, make one change, which you already did. In the holy month of Ramadan, you made that change, you did it. You decide which ones, and if not all, but start with the one that you think is more important to you and that you can handle it and do it bit by bit. This is keeping the momentum going, and hopefully we will see the change when Ramadan meets us again next year. From myself, Khawa Solomon, wassalamu alaikum, and goodbye for now.